Good morning all. Today we are going to start next topic, which are in class conservation. And in general class conservation, you know that the DNA present in the total number of cells, and combined we are calling general class. So whether maybe that the DNA present in the nucleus, it may be present in the mitochondria or chloroplast. So combinedly, these are all type of DNA we are calling germplasm. So when we are conserving these germplasm material in the laboratory technique or inside the in vivo condition, so that we are calling germplasm conservation. So in today's topic, we will learn how different methods we can utilize to conserve the germplasm. Now first we will see the introduction. The total of the all genes present in a crop, that its related species constituents, it is germplasm. So it is ordinarily represented by a collection of various strains and species. So any species or strain, if they are having or if they are comprises the DNA material or genes, so we are calling germplasm. So germplasm provide the raw materials which the breeder uses to develop commercial crop varieties. So in agriculture science, the crop varieties, we need to improve. So plant breeders require germplasm as a raw material. So therefore, the germplasm is the basic indispensable ingredient of all breeding program, and a greater emphasis is placed on collection, evolution and conservation of the germplasm. So we have to put focus on the germplasm collection and evolution and conservation. Then only if we will conserve, so that in the future time, if we don't have germplasm, so you can thrive it and you can utilize for the production of new crop varieties. Then conventionally, germplasm is conserved as seed store at ambient temperature, low temperature or ultra low temperature. So the conventional method for germplasm conservation is the storing the seed material on the low temperature, and we can also use the ultra low temperature, like minus 180 degree or minus 196 degree in the nitrogen. So these are all germplasm material we can able to conserve using the in vitro and in vivo techniques. So germplasm can be conserved by two ways. So first one is the in situ conservation, and second one is ex situ conservation. So in situ conservation, when we are conserving the germplasm in the their natural habitat. So if plant is conserving in the natural habitat, we are calling the in situ conservation. So many plant varieties we are conserving their natural habitat so that they will be persist in the net. Next is in ex situ conservation. So in the ex situ conservation, we are not conserving the plant material inside their natural habitat. So we are conserving in the seed bank or in the field collection. So where the plant is growing in the natural habitat, so that is now there we are not conserving. So we have to bring the plant material and we are conserving in the seed bank and the field collection. So in species which are propagated through seed, it is economic to prevent the preserve these seeds. So these seeds are dried to water content to 5 to 8%. Then we are storing into the low temperature, like minus 18 degree centigrade or lower than that. And humidity we will maintain it so that the seeds will not be completely dried. So the seeds material we are storing in the low temperature so that whenever we are needed, we have available seeds for the seed germination. So here we are, you can see in this photograph, the test tubes, you are having the in vitro storage of the seeds. Next is advantage of in vitro conservation over in vivo conservation. So in vitro culture enable plant species that are danger of being extinct to be conserved. So we can easily conserve those species which is in the danger or red listed plant. So red listed or endangered plant we can easily conserve using the in vitro culture technique. So in vitro storage of the vegetatively propagated plant can result in the bread saving in storage space and bag. Sterile plant that cannot be propagated generatively can be maintained in the in vitro condition. So it is possible in vitro to efficiently reduce growth, which decrease the number of subculture. In vitro is the only safe way to ensuring that it remains this way. Now, approaches of germplasm conservation may be applied in following aspects. So first approach is the conservation. Second one is the slow growth culture, desiccated somatic embryo and artificial seeds. And we can also use the DNA clones. So one by one we will discuss. First one is the cryopreservation. Cryopreservation, the word originated from the Latin word and it was originated from the cryos. Cryos means frost. You are freezing something in the very low temperature. So cryo, where we are preserving something on the very low temperature. So storage at the very low temperature, like solid carbon dioxide, which is having temperature 80 degrees and minus 80 degrees centigrade, and in low temperature deep freezer like minus 80 degrees or above, in vapor phase of the nitrogen minus 150 degrees centigrade, or in the liquid nitrogen minus 196 degrees centigrade. So these different conditions we can able to utilize by the different chemicals like solid carbon dioxide or liquid nitrogen or vapor phase of the nitrogen we can utilize. So at the low temperature, the cells stay in completely inactive state and the all metabolic and biochemical activity will be arrested. So the theoretical basis of the freeze preservation is the transfer of water present in the cell to the solid state. So while pure water become ice at 0 degrees centigrade, the cell water needs a much lower temperature because of freezing point depression by salt or the organic molecules. Plant cells, they are having many salts and biomolecules. So these salt biomolecules, they are suspended inside the water. So that's why the water inside the cells, they will not freeze on the 0 degrees centigrade. And it requires much more lower temperature to freeze them. So the lowest temperature at which water has been demonstrated to be liquid is minus 68 degrees centigrade. The storage at a very low temperature considerably slow down or halts the metabolic process, biological deterioration. So this is metabolic processes and biochemical process we will stop and we can store at very low temperature. If water will be crystallized or it will be not available for the biomolecules and other biochemical purpose, so that all the reaction present in the cellular level, it will be stopped. So easily we can able to stop all the activity of the cells and then we can preserve very easily. Then step involved in the cryopreservation. First is the raising sterile tissue culture. So the first step, you have to raise the sterile tissue culture, and the tissue culture should be free from the paste, bacteria, fungi, protozoa, or any other microbes. So if you are raising the pure tissues of the plants, so that this plant tissues can be utilized for the cryopreservation. Then you have to add the cryoprotectant or pre-treatment. So if you will add some chemical which will protect when you are freezing them in the very low temperature, so that these cryoprotectant can able to save these type of tissues for damaging from inside to outside or outside to inside. So you have to protect these tissues and cells by putting these cryoprotectant and pre-treatment. Then you have to do freezing, and freezing you can do by two methods. You can slowly freeze, or you can do fast freezing. Then you have, after the freezing, you have to store the material in the particular storage, like solid carbon dioxide storage system or liquid nitrogen storage system. Then after some time, if you want to remove like 5 year or 6 year or 10 year, or in case of liquid nitrogen, so you can preserve liquid nitrogen around 100 to 500 year, like that. So if you want to again thaw it, so the thawing process can be done by slow thawing process or fast thawing process. So after that, the tissue will be ready for the again and some culturing, and you can able to propagate a healthy plant. Then determination of survival and viability. You have in this process, you have to determine the how many cells is having viability or how many number of cells is in the live condition. In when we are doing carb preservation, many cells will be dying. So we have to determine the number of cells, how many number of cells is viable or not. Then we can again culture it on the growth media. Then raising sterile tissue culture. Now first step, raising sterile tissue culture. So different type of tissue can be used to freeze, such as the apical, lateral meristem, plant organs, seeds, culture plant, somatic embryos, protoplasm, and callus. So these are all plant tissues, cells, and organ you can able to utilize for cryopreservation preservation. So there is no restriction. You can't able to say the any type of you can able to use the any type of plant material for cryopreservation purpose. But if you will see the callus cells, they are more utilized for the cryopreservation, because the callus cells can able to generate a number of plant, and they are, since they are 100, they are totipotent. So they, from the callus cells you can able to easily prepare the healthy plant plates. In general, the small, richy cytoplasmic meristematic cells survive better than the large, highly vacuolated cells. So cell suspension have been successfully frozen in the number of species. So till date, many plants we successfully frozen in various stages. And the plant material, if they are having many vacuoles, so that it is not suitable for the cryopreservation. So in general, we are using the small cells of the plants, richy cytoplasm and meristematic cells also very good for the cryopreservation. So these should be in the late low phase or exponential cells. And callus tissues, particularly among tropical species, are more resistant to freezing, damage, and have also been used. So as we already discussed that plant callus is more suitable for the germplasm conservation in the low temperature, and the whatever cells you are taking from the protoplast culture or callus culture, the cells should be in the low phase or the exponential phase. If the cells in the stationary or in the death phase, so they will be not survive, because they will be in the under stressful condition, and again you will put the low temperature, so they will easily die. So you have to use the low phase and exponential phase cells. So a rapidly growing stage of the callus shortly after 1 or more weeks of transplantation to the media is best for cryopreservation. So old cell at the top of the callus and blackened area should be avoided. Culture cells are not the ideal system for cryopreservation. If you are choosing the cells from the top of the layer of the callus, and the cells which is having dark type of color and the black or brown color, so they are the old type of cells, and if you always have to avoid these type of old cells. So always the cells which is actively growing, or you can say they are in the exponential phase. So you have to select those cells, and you can utilize those cells for the cryopreservation. So if you will select the rapidly growing cells from the callus culture, so it will be more suitable for the cryopreservation. Then addition of cryoprotectant and pre-treatment. So always we have to pre-treatment, or you can use the cryoprotectant when you are using the cryopreservation, because when you are storing in the very low temperature, so some water will be there, and this water will be crystallized, and it will damage the cellular organelles inside the cells. So that's why we have to use the cryoprotectant, and we have to give the pre-treatment. So seeds are one of the most preferred examples explant for storage due to ease of handling, and seeds can be successfully stored at minus 20 degrees centigrade after desiccating to the 5 to 7% moisture content without loss of viability. And using conventional storage method, we can easily store on the minus 20 degrees centigrade. And for example, black pepper, coffee, coconut rubber, and tea seeds, we can easily preserve using this method. So if you are going to preserve the seed, so what you have to do, you have to dry up to the 5 to 7% moisture, and then you have to keep those seeds in the minus 30 degrees centigrade, so that for the longer duration it will be safe. And in between, if you want to check the viability of the seeds, so you can grow in the natural environment and or in vitro condition, so that you can able to know the viability of the seeds. These cannot be desiccated to low moisture content without substantial loss of viability, and hence are difficult to conserve even for short period at low temperature. Thus, the following pre-treatment of desiccation can be used before freezing. So this process involves air desiccation, pre-growth desiccation, encapsulation, dehydration, and vitrification. So when we are doing or when we are removing the moisture content from the seeds, so many methods we can follow. So we can put the seeds inside the shed condition, so that the automatically the air will blow and slowly the seeds will be dry. Or you can use the pre-growth desiccation, or you can use some chemical encapsulation, so that chemical will absorb the water content from the seeds, and then it will be having 5 to 7% moisture content. Then vitrification is another matter where you can remove or you can maintain the 5 to 7% moisture content. Now next is freezing. So three different type of freezing procedure we developed, and various type of cryostat and freezing units are available for which different cooling rates can be easily regulated. So first one is the rapid freezing, second one is the slow freezing, third one is the stepwise freezing. These different freezing mechanisms depend on the what type of tissue you are freezing. In rapid freezing, we are decreasing the temperature very fast, so that the plant will not have the crystals. We are not giving time water to form the crystals, so that the plant directly will be freeze, so that in the rapid manner, so that it will not have the water crystal. Then in the slow freezing, we are slowly decreasing the time, and stepwise freezing, we are stepwise decreasing the time, like minus 20, minus 22, minus 40, minus 42, minus 60, minus 60 to 120, then minus 160, and then minus 196 degrees. So in step-by-step manner, we are freezing the cryopreservation. Next is storage. So the frozen cells or tissues are immediately kept for the storage temperature from minus 70 degree to minus 196 degree centigrade. So aliquot of a nitrogen refrigerator running at minus 150 degree centigrade and in the vapor phase, or minus 196 degree centigrade in between liquid phase of the nitrogen, is ideal for the storage purpose. If you are looking for the very longer duration, so you have to use these two type of condition. Either you have to put your tissues and cells in the vapor phase of the liquid nitrogen, vapor phase of the nitrogen, or you can utilize the liquid nitrogen itself. So both is having different temperature. So liquid nitrogen is having minus 196 degree centigrade, whereas if you are using only vapor of the nitrogen, so that it is having lower temperature, like minus 150 degree centigrade. So you have to decide what type of temperature you can utilize for this purpose. So the temperature should be sufficiently low for the long-term storage of the cells, and you can stop the metabolic and biochemical activities, or any biochemical or metabolic injuries also you can able to get rid of. If you are saving the plant cells and tissue material for the very longer duration, like 100 to 200 years, so you can able to store in the liquid nitrogen. Otherwise, if you are looking for the small duration, like 1 year or 2 years, then you can choose the minus 150 degree centigrade. So long-term storage is the best on the minus 196 degree centigrade. So the injury caused to the cell should be due to freezing or storage, and the latter occur primarily when the cells are not stored sufficiently in the low temperature. Now the thawing. So it is usually carried out by putting the ampules containing the sample in the warm water, like 35 to 45 degree centigrade for thawing, and frozen tips of the sample in the tubes and ampules are plunged into the warm water with a vigorous swirling. This rest action just to point off the oil dispenses. So thawing is a process where we are taking back the culture which is preserved in the cryopreservation, and we are coming back into the normal temperature. So normally what we are doing, we are taking out the ampules and we are directly putting the warm water which is having 235 to 45 degrees centigrade. For survival, the tissue, the tubes should not be left in the warm bath after the ice melt, and just at the point of thawing, quickly transfer the tube at the water bath, maintain at the room temperature 20 to 25 degrees centigrade, and continue to swirling action for 15 centigrade to put the warm balls of the tubes. So when we are leaving the for the longer duration the our sample in the water bath, like 35 to 45 degrees centigrade, so the chances there that our cells will be damaged, because 35 to 45 degree temperature and for the longer duration plant cell will be got damaged. So that we should not leave for the longer duration, and we have to put these cells in our tissues in the 20 to 25 degree centigrade, and then continue with the washing and culture transfer procedure. And it is necessary to avoid extensive damage to fragile tissues or cells too by minimizing the amount of handling at pre-growth stages. Next is determination of survival viability. So it is very important step after the cryopreservation. You have to determine the how many cells or tissues is having survival rate or viability. So regrowth of the plant is depend on the survivability. If more number of cells is survive, so you have very good result in the culture. If you are having some few cells, then only you have to very cautious, because the few cells if you will die while the reculturing, so that if they will be die, so that you don't have you will lose your culture entirely. So at the any stage of the viability of frozen cells can be determined, and cell viability test FDA standing growth measurement by employing parameter like cell number, packed cell volume, dry and fresh bed, mitotic index have already known, and we already do, we can do while freezing and while cryopreservation. Every time we can take it to some small amount of the tissues and cells, and we can check on the various duration. So after the checking the survivability and viability of the cells and tissues, you can again can utilize these cells which is having which was survived and the having viability for the culture purpose. So other standing method for triphenyl tetrazolium chloride or TTC and Evans blue dye also you can utilize for the checking the viability of the cells and the tissues. Next is the plant growth and regeneration. So after the viability checking, you have to use these cells for the plant regeneration. You can put these cells and tissues in the freshly prepared media in the in vitro condition. You can put and you can regenerate the plant heads. So the freshly cured cells is strongly prone to further damage and require appropriate nursing. Regrowth of the cryopreserved material would depend upon the manner in which specimens are handled, such as planting the cells without washing away the cryoprotectant incorporation. Cryoprotectant incorporation of species additive in the regrowth medium of the physical environmental condition, and the cells exposed to during the early stage of the regrowth. So the cryoprotectant may be removed either by the washing with the culture media or by planting the cured culture onto a filter paper cap on the medium, like Gossypium hirsutum. So Gossypium hirsutum, you can able to preserve from the longer duration, and you can able to wash out the cryoprotectant when you before the culturing again. So addition of certain compounds in the medium during the regrowth has shown increased survival ability, like GA3 in the medium for freeze preserved tissue strip of tomato, activated charcoal for carrot. So it depends on the plant tissues to tissues or species to species how you have to treat. But for the standardization, you have to standardize the protocol by changing the environment by the change in the different condition. Next is slow growth culture. In this method, shoot culture are maintained in the state of the slow growth, usually imposed by low temperature, a growth rate retardant or elevated osmotic concentration of the media. Other factors like culture vessel size, nutrient and restriction, and gas restriction also affect the culture growth. So in the slow growth culture method, you can reduce the growth of the plant so that the duration of the transferring from fresh media you can extend. So when you will extend the duration of the culture condition, so the requirement of the again and subculture will be reduced. So in the slow growth phase, you can add some, you can change the environmental condition like temperature and the humidity, and you can reduce the media concentration different. You can reduce the different media concentration so that plant growth will be reduced, and you can have the slow growth culture condition. Then next is factor involved in the slow growth culture like low temperature, low oxygen pressure, nutrient restriction, growth regulator, and osmotics. So these are all conditions you can maintain in single or in the multiple combination. It depends on the type of species or plant material you are using for the low, slow, or slow growth culture condition. Now, one by one, we will discuss every condition. First is the low temperature. So the tissue can be cultured at the low temperature. Normally, we are culturing tissues in the laboratory 24 degrees centigrade to 26 degrees centigrade. But if you are culturing for the on the slow growth, so you can reduce the temperature like 1 to 4 degrees centigrade, where they will not be completely freeze. But since temperature is not suitable for the growth and the development of the plant cells, that's why their growth will be very slow. And you can save the, you can maintain to 43 to 4 weeks under the standard growth condition. So you can increase the timing, and where you in the normal condition on the normal temperature 24 degrees centigrade, the plant will have to subculture every 15 to 20 days. If you will maintain 1 to 2 or 4 degrees centigrade, so that you can able to extend for 4 to 5 weeks. So the explant are the transferred to low temperature of 1 to 4 degrees centigrade for culture. Normally growth at 20 to 25 degrees centigrade and to 4 to 10 degrees for culture, normally grown at the 30 degrees centigrade. 16-hour photo period with the reduced lighting may be also very beneficial, because low light period if you will give, so that the photosynthesis also will be reduced and plant will grow very slowly. The storage of the culture cells under low temperature has shown limited success. Cultures have been stored at low temperature for a prolonged period of 9 months to 17 months in Musa and Linoleum is achieved. So here in the photograph you can able to see the method of the cryopreservation. First we have to select the material, like callus is best material as we already know. So we have to treat the cryoprotectant. And for cryoprotectant, we can use mainly 10% DNA. So, and sucrose, we can increase 0.3 mol per liter. And the material we can able to put into the cryoprotection for 1 hour. And then after that, we can decrease the temperature like minus 7.5 degree centigrade, and time induction 5 seconds. So this pre-freezing we can give for 2 hours, and after that we can decrease further up to minus 40 degree centigrade. Then we can store the plant material. We can store the plant material on the minus 196 degree centigrade and directly putting in these ampoules in the liquid nitrogen. So suppose if you want to take it back these plant material and you want to prepare the plant plates, so you have to thawing. For thawing, the best method is putting these culture from the cryopreservation directly at the plus 40 degree centigrade, and then we have to put after the 10 to 15 minutes on the normal temperature like 22 to 25 degrees centigrade. Then you have to check the viability, and after the checking the viability, you have to culture it from the medium. You have to culture it and you can regenerate the plant roots. Next parameter is low oxygen pressure. So oxygen pressure can be regulated by the atmospheric or partial pressure, and generally tissue growth reduces when oxygen pressure also decreasing. So if we are providing low oxygen concentration, so definitely it is having negative effect on the plant growth, and we can able to achieve the low growth of the plant when we are providing low oxygen pressure. So this is because low oxygen intake by culture material result in a decrease in carbon dioxide production during low oxygen storage. So the major limitation in using low oxygen storage for germplasm conservation is the long term effect of the low partial pressure of the oxygen on the plant steady round powder growth. Next is the nutrient restriction. We can also reduce the nutrient component of the media, and we can use the half strength media or 1/4 extra media, so that plant how much they are required the nutrition, we can be able to control it so that ultimately the growth of the plant will be reduced. So it is better if individual nutrient are restricted or all together eliminated. So if you are removing one by one component, then if you are reducing the growth, it will be more better as you are just reducing the strength of the media 1/4 or 1/2. For example, shoot apex grow on the MS media with 6% of ammonium nitrate show 70-80% survival and greatly reduce the growth rate. Next is the growth regulator. So we can use the growth regulator like succinic acid, 2-2-dimethylhydrazine, cyclo-C-abscisic acid, peclobutrazole, triiodobenzoic acid. So these growth regulator, if you will use, so they will reduce the growth of the plant material, and then you have time for the saving for the culture. So these chemical cause reduced growth in any shorter internode of the plants. Next parameter is osmotics. So high level of different osmoticum such as pannitol, sorbitol or sucrose with concentration ranging from 3-6% we can able to utilize. So the high level of the compound act as a osmotic inhibitor which should slow down the growth. So virus free strawberry plant were maintained for 6 years at 4°C. Rare plant have been stored for 15 years at 9°C. So a suitable osmoticum we can utilize for the growth reduction like mannitol or sorbitol or sucrose also you can utilize, because sucrose plant material or plants they can utilize for the biochemical and metabolic activity. So if you are increasing the concentration of the adequate osmoticum, so that you can able to reduce the plant growth. Then desiccated somatic embryos and artificial seeds. So the technique for desiccation of somatic embryos and for production of desiccated artificial seeds are now becoming available. In this technique, we are removing the water content of the seeds so that the water content is not available in the plant seeds, so that we can able to preserve from the longer duration. So the desiccated somatic embryos and artificial seed can be stored at low temperature, 4°C or ultra, or we can also say one thing very low temperature like -20°C. So this approach is yet to evaluate for such an application involved a complicated desiccation procedure and can be applied only to those species genotype where somatic embryos regeneration happen at the adequate frequency. Then DNA clones. So germplasm can also be conserved in form of DNA segments cloned in a suitable vector like osmids, plasmid or yeast artificial chromosome. So directly we will isolate the entire genome of the plant species, and then these plant species we can cut it down using the restriction and enzyme, and we can clone inside the vector, suitable vector like a big size of vector you can utilize like osmid, plasmids and yeast artificial chromosome to save the DNA. So this technique is very sophisticated and latest, and it is in the demanding, but the drawback also there since it is having labor intensive and expensive. It is likely to be used for conservation of valuable genes or DNA segment from threatened species and conservation of the entire genome of various germplasm line of different species may never become feasible. Now, application of cryopreservation. So first is the we can able to conserve the genetic material, and for longer duration like 100 to 500 years we can able to easily save. Then freezing storage of the cell culture. So when you will freeze the cell culture, you can access those cells without subculturing again and again, and it will be very easy when you are thriving again and you are producing the plant. Then maintenance of disease-free stocks also it is possible, and you can store those disease-free plants and tissues, and whenever you are required, so you can take it back and you can culture again. Then cold acclimation and frost resistance variety of issues also you can able to reduce using cryopreservation. Then main crop reduce recipient of short-lived seeds. Similarly, in case of clone, crop seeds are not the best material to conserve due to their genetic heterogeneity and unknown origin. Their genes need to be conserved. So it is important to conserve the endangered plant or else some of the valuable genetic traits present in the existing and primitive plant will be lost. So because of the multiple applications, the cryopreservation is the main choice for the saving the plant material in the proper condition. So as every technique is having limitations, so cryopreservation also having some limitation. First limitation is the great skill and handling is required. So every time when you are trying to cryoprotect the tissues and plant cells, so it required a great handling and maintenance of the facility. So sophisticated facilities is required when you are cryoprotect the plant material and tissues. So plants may show genetic instability when you are preserving in the cryopreservation. So cell tissue get damaged very easily when you are cryopreserving cells and tissues. And cryopreservation procedure are genotype dependent. So different type of species can be utilized for the cryopreservation purpose. So cost also very large when you are having developed the sophisticated cryoprotectant cryopreservation facility. So cost of the maintenance of the facility and the cryopreservation will be great, and that's why every lab don't have each type of facility. Then slow growth culture are vulnerable for the contamination. That's why every time when you are growing the plant cells and tissues, and when you are culturing these plant material in the slow growth condition, so that they are very vulnerable for the contamination. So large storage spaces is required, especially for slow growth culture condition. Now some important books we will see. First one, the plant cell and tissue culture by Indra K. Vassil and Trevor A. Thorpe. Second book, the plant cell and tissue culture, a tool in biotechnology. Basics and Application Principle and Practice by Carl Harman Newman and Ashwini Kumar. Next book, The Plant Cell and Tissue Culture Methods in Molecular Biology by Jeffrey W. Pollard and John M. Roper. Then fourth book, Plant Cell and Tissue Culture for the Production of Food Ingredients by Gong, Zhang Fu and Lu Xing. Then fifth book is Plant Biotechnology by H.S. Chawla. Now some important questions we will see. Space is the advantages of the seed as germplasm conservation, except option A, plant are propagated through seeds. Option B, seed viability is enhanced over a time. Option C, conventional material to conserve plant germplasm. Option D, seeds occupy a small space. So you have to select the correct answer from the options. Then next question, which of the following is the appropriate method for cryopreservation? Option A, over solid carbon dioxide at minus 79 degree centigrade. Then option B, low temperature deep freezer at minus 80 degree centigrade. Then option C, in vapor phase of nitrogen at minus 150 degree centigrade. And option D, in liquid nitrogen at minus 196 degree centigrade. So again, you have to choose the correct option. Then next question, the following are the cryoprotectant except option A, glycerol, option B, mannitol, option C, DMSO, option D, methanol. So you have to choose the correct answer. And next question, coral protectant are used in the coral preservation to space. Can be space it will come. Option A, prevent damage caused to cell by freezing. Option B, to preserve cells from the pathogens. Option C, to preserve cells from the freezing. Option D, to preserve cells from the aggregation. So again, we have to select the correct answer. And next question, the use of very low temperature to preserve the cells and tissues to maintain their viability is called. Option A, deep freeze. Option B, cryopreservation. Option C, cooling. Option D, cryoprotecting. So again, you have to select the correct answer. And next question, which of the following is used to produce very low temperature for cryopreservation? Option A, solid water. Option B, liquid nitrogen. Option C, liquid sulfur dioxide. Option D, liquid hydrogen. So again, you have to choose the correct answer. Then next question, which of the following is a not important application of cryopreservation? Option A, freezing and storage of the hematopoietic stem cells. Option B, storage of rare germplasm. Option C, freezing of cell culture. Option D, in metal industry. So again, you have to choose the correct answer. Then next question, preservation of germplasm in a frozen state is option A, cryopreservation. Option B, dry storage. Option C, cold storage. Option D, in the oven. So again, you have to choose the correct answer. Then next question, temperature usually used for cryopreservation is option A, -196°C. Option B, -10°C. Option C, -2°C. Option D, -20°C. So you have to choose the again correct answer. And thank you for being with us. And we will meet you again in the next class. Thank you.